Do you remember that time in your life when you felt like life was so long, time lasted so long? I mean, even the Christmas break took forever to get there. And you thought when you were like in the first grade that you would never get into high school driving, would just no way. You know, it's so long. Time just goes forever. And then something happens that just radically speeds it up, like when a friend of mine in elementary school, her sister was killed in a car accident, and all of a sudden there's this, whoa, wait a minute, you mean something could be just cut short like that? And as you grow older, and you might be in that time when it feels like time's going to last forever, but as time goes on, you get more and more accustomed to the thought that, wait a minute, time is actually very short. It actually is extremely short. And so we begin to think when you're like my age that, man, life is really short, but we still don't get it. We still put so much into this little life as though it's such a big thing, as though this little life that is so very short, we don't recognize how insignificant this time is compared to the time for which we were created. And Francis Chan did a phenomenal job with describing this when he took a rope and like this rope here. And he said, look, if this rope, just imagine this rope was 100 miles long. And if I took a rope 100 miles long, and if I tied this this cord around the rope just to mark one little thin spot on that rope representing that distance, it would be too big, too wide, too much relative to the time that we have. In fact, if you stretch this cord out to the known end of the universe, 14 billion light years worth of rope, and you were to tie that string to represent not just your life, but all of human history, that would be too big. All of human history is but a blink in the light of the eternity for which you and I were created. And with that in mind, some people start asking the question about the end of time. The end of time. When is it going to end? And when will we actually be facing this eternity that we were created for? And when you ask that question, like right now, those things that feel like it's speeding up time a little bit, like pandemic and storms and wars and pestilence and all kinds of things happening around us, and people are asking, you know, could this be the end? Well, at this time, then you have lots of people stepping up to speak about the end of time. You have lots of people stepping up to speak about prophecies like the book of Revelation and other things. And if you're like me, I receive lots of those. And so I get lots of sermons sent to me, say, please listen to this. And sometimes I love you guys. I don't have time to listen to all of the sermons that are sent to me. But in that process, you hear so many different perspectives and so many different views and people you highly respect saying totally different things about what to look for and when's it going to happen and all that kind of stuff. Wouldn't it be cool? Don't you wish that Jesus would just like come down and give us an end time message? You know what I'm saying? Like say, here, let me tell you, you know, if you could just sit down with Jesus and say, Jesus, when's it going to happen? And he'd say, let me tell you, you know, what do we need to look for? And he'd say, let me tell you. Well, guess what? He did. And if you did what we ask you to do as you're preparing for this message today, you already know that because it's in Matthew chapter 24 that it says that Jesus had left the temple and was walking away when his disciples came up to call his attention to its buildings. Do you see all these things he said? Not one stone will be left on another. I tell you, everyone will be thrown down. Then when Jesus was on the Mount of Olives, his disciples came to him privately and asked, Lord, tell us, when is this going to happen? And what is the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? So they're asking, what signs do we look for that you are coming and that the age is coming to end, that time is coming to an end, that this is going to be it and everything's going to culminate? He goes on and says, watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name claiming to be the Messiah and deceive many people. And he says, you'll hear of wars and rumors of wars. He says, but see to it that you're not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Then he goes on and says, nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. These are the beginning of birth pangs. It's kind of moving in toward it. He said, then you'll be handed over to be persecuted and be put to death. And then it says, you'll be hated by all nations because of me. And many will turn away from the faith and betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will arise and deceive many people. And because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most, he says, will grow cold. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. And then he says, in this gospel of the kingdom needs to be preached to the whole world as a testimony to all nations. And then he said, the end will come. So he says in verse 15 there, and he's answering the question in verse 15 of chapter 24, he says, so when you see the abomination that causes desolation standing in the holy place, the abomination that causes desolation spoken of through the prophet Daniel, he said, let the reader understand. He says, okay, when you see the abomination that causes desolation spoken of by the prophet Daniel standing in the holy place, let the reader understand. You need to know that's the sign to look for. And then he says, then let everyone in Jerusalem flee to the mountains. He says, and let those on the rooftop not go down to take anything out of the house. Just get out of there. Anybody in the field, don't go back to get your cloak. You need to get out because it's going to be bad. He says, how dreadful it will be for pregnant women and nursing mothers in those days. And he says, pray that your flight does not take place in winter or on a Sabbath. He said, because then there will be great distress, unequaled from the beginning of the world or the creation of the world until now and never to be equaled again. And so Jesus, having said that, he's saying, look, this is going to be that great, great time of tribulation. So if you ever hear people talk about prophecy, they'll speak of the great tribulation. That great tribulation that Jesus spoke about, he spoke about here as he talked about the end, Matthew chapter 24, verse 15 and 16. So as you read that, then you probably, if you aren't a student of scripture or prophecy, you may get really confused at this point. So what we're going to try to do is just make it plain. We're going to try to make it simple. Nehemiah 8:8 says this, they read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people could understand what was being read. So let's just read what Jesus was quoting from. Jesus was quoting again from the book of Daniel, and he's in the book of Daniel in chapter 9. And we again ask you to read that, okay? So if you've read it, you've already seen this. But in verse 24, here's what Daniel was told by Gabriel, the angel. He said, 77s are decreed for your people and your holy city to finish transgressions, to put an end to sin, to atone for wickedness, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy place. Now, if you've read the book of Daniel, you understand what he's saying. He's saying they're going to be 70, and this says sevens in New International Version. If you read a translation that's more literal, it's literally weeks. He said they're going to be 70 weeks. And that expression of 70 weeks, you will often hear people use that. They'll say the 70 weeks of Daniel or the 70th week of Daniel. So that thing you've probably heard, but maybe not even understand. So here he says there are going to be 70 weeks that are going to lead up to everything being ready. Sin has been dealt with. Transgression has been dealt with. Sin's been atoned for. Everything's ready. Everlasting righteousness can come in. Everything can be as it's supposed to be. The end of time as we know it and the beginning of the eternity for which you were created. He's saying it's going to be 70 weeks. So you might be like, well, wait a minute, 70 weeks. And then it goes on in verse 25 of Daniel chapter 9. He says, know and understand this. From the time the word goes out to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the anointed one, the ruler, comes, there will be seven sevens. So he's saying there will be one period of seven weeks. And I need to be using weeks here so you get the literal. But that there will be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. It will be rebuilt with streets in a trench, but in times of trouble. After 62 weeks, the anointed one will be put to death and have nothing. Now, then you go and say, okay, now, well, what in the world? So he's talking about this 7 weeks and 62 weeks. So that's 69 weeks. And at the end of the 69 weeks, the anointed one is going to be cut off. And you're going like, what? What is this all about? So in an effort to try to make it plain, let's just put out some simple ways of looking at this. And this is pretty much to scale, and I'll show you that later. But pretty much to scale, this is the history from Adam until Daniel. Okay, so from Adam to Daniel, there's about a 2,000-year period there. Then here, and the world is a mess, and just like it is today. People hurting people, people hating people, it's a mess. But as the world's a mess, he comes to Daniel, and the people are looking for, when's the world going to be made right? What's going to be the end of time as we know it, and we'll start living the eternity for which we were created? And the answer is, they're going to be 69 weeks up until this thing happens where the anointed one or the Messiah will be cut off. Now, that 69 weeks, here's what we've said to you about prophecy. We've said that when it comes to apocalyptic, speaking of end time, visions and revelations, that they are representative. And so in the book of Daniel, nobody believes that the vision of the four beasts that come out of the sea in his dream in chapter 7, the lion and the bear and the leopard and the terrifying and frightening beast with iron teeth, nobody believes they're literal. Everybody knows that they represent something. They represent nations. So Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, Rome. So it's representing nations. Now, how do we know that? Because actually, it's interpreted for Daniel. So he's told this isn't literal. It's representing something. So the 69 weeks that are being talked about here among those 70 weeks, it's not literal. It's representing something. So what does it represent is the question. Now, when it represents something, it represents something very real, okay? Very real, but what does it represent? So it could be that 69 weeks was literally 69 weeks. And when it was given, it could have been, and there was a question, it might have been. It might have represented literal seven-day periods. Then there was the possibility that it might represent years, that each one of those weeks might be a year, or maybe each one of the days in the week might be a year. There's so many different possibilities. And early on, it was interpreted different ways. And today, there are people who will say that those weeks are actually called, Jubilee years are represented in those. And then it's tallied up to be 3,500 years from the time he prophesied it. So there's all kinds of possibilities. But let's just try one. What if the possibility is that a week, it's a week in that literally in the Hebrew, it's seven consecutive days are being referred to in that word. But what if it represented not days, but years? What if each one of the days in that were years? So what if each week was a period of 7 years? If that was the case, then 69 weeks would mean 483 years. Okay, so 483 years. Well, what's he saying about those 483 years? You remember what we read in Daniel. He's saying from the time that the word goes out to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. That's back in verse 25, I believe. He says from the time the word goes out to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, then from that time, these whole 70 weeks are going to be taking place. So when he's speaking of these first 69 out of those 70 weeks, he's saying from the time that the decree goes out to build, rebuild, and restore Jerusalem from the time the word goes out. Now, that period of time then, if you were to say these days in these weeks represent years, and this was 483 years, and you look back to one of the decrees. Now, there were four different decrees to rebuild either the temple or other parts of Jerusalem, but the most complete decree was the fourth one offered by Artaxerxes in 444 BC. So if you go to 444 BC, right here, right then when that decree, and that was the one that included rebuilding the walls and making everything as it should be, from that decree in 444 BC, if you go 483 years and you take into account the difference in the Jewish calendar and the Gregorian calendar, guess where it puts you? It puts you to a year 33 AD. Now, if you're not have no understanding of what the significance of 33 AD is that happens to be the year in which Jesus was telling his disciples this. It happens to be that he's telling them that in the year 33 AD as he sits on the Mount of Olives. And when he says this, they immediately are going like, whoa, wait a minute. Look at what he's tying it back to the prophecies of Daniel. Daniel had said that after 69 weeks, which wasn't literal weeks, but was actually 69 periods of 7 years each, that after that, 483 years later, the anointed one, the Messiah, would be cut off. There's no doubt about it that that means will be killed. And he's speaking that 3 days before he's going to his crucifixion. Now, most people look at that and they go like, whoa, that is like, oh, that's just too amazing. It just aligns up too, just so remarkably. And so right now, maybe you've got a little bit of understanding. So you say, okay, man, now I get what Jesus was saying. And he's, but what's this thing, the abomination that causes desolation that was going to be set up? Because that's going to happen in the 70th week. So listen to this as we continue on. It says that... the end will come. Then a ruler, and this is the middle of chapter 9, verse 26, the people of the ruler who will come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end will come like a flood. War will continue to the end, and desolations have been decreed. He will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7. In the middle of the seven, he will put an end to sacrifice and offering, and at the temple, he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end. That decree is, until the end, that is decreed, is poured out on him. Okay? So he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him. Now, that, referring to this ruler who will come, is saying that the ruler who will come, not speaking of the Messiah, but speaking of this ruler who will come, who we know as the Antichrist, who we know as the little horn, who we know as all kinds of other things, but this ruler who will come is going to bring the abomination that causes desolation into the temple. And Jesus is saying, when you see that, then you know it's happening. You're right in it. Get ready. And he goes on to say that look, this is going to happen. And once these things have happened, the end is right there. It's right at the door. Now, with that thought in mind, everything would be really cool up to this point if, as we look at that last week, right, there's 1 week left, the 70th week, and you hear people talk about the 70th week of Daniel, and they'll look and they'll say, well, what's happening next? Well, if everything had ended in the next 7 years, you know, that would be great. In 70 AD, the temple was destroyed. And Jesus talked about this, every one of these stones is going to be cast down. That did happen in 70 AD. But people go, but wait a minute, all these were fulfilled in 7 year increments. And this last 7 years, by the time 7 years had passed, it wasn't completely fulfilled. And so how do we handle that? I want to tell you that right now, I don't want to say to you, I know I'm right. I love a person who said this in this way. They said, you know, one of the tragedies of human beings is this, is that we often know enough to think that we're right, but we don't know enough to know that we're wrong. And so reality is that I'm not saying that I'm right, but I want you to have a framework in which to look at this so you can fully understand it. So let me tell you about a few of the many, but these are three dominant ways of answering the question, okay, what's next? So that we do know, when is that very end going to come? When does the end of time come? All right, so one is this. One is what we call a position called the preterist view, okay? And the preterist view is this. That means preterist really speaks of past. So the preterist view is that really that last week, that one last week, that 7 years was fulfilled all within the first century. So when it came to the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, to the persecution under Nero, to all that was happening in that generation, that it was actually fulfilling everything that you read about in the Revelation, everything that was spoken of in Daniel, and that what happens after that is everything's done with concerning the Jews in a sense, and the church takes over from that point, and the church age then carries on from there. So the preterist view is it was all fulfilled during that period of time. Now, my personal opinion is you read and you look at the evidence people present, biblical evidence, internal evidence biblically, and look at historical evidence and stuff that speaks into that and say, okay, how much evidence is there? There's a tremendous amount of evidence for the idea that a whole lot of stuff was fulfilled in that time. And you look at what's written in the Revelation, you look what was happening in the Roman Empire, you look at the destruction of Jerusalem, you look at all the things that happened, and so there's a lot of evidence. But most people would agree, there's a lot that wasn't fulfilled in completion. And so, but that's one way of looking at this, okay? Now, there's another way of looking at this, and that position is called the futurist position. And the futurist position says this, that when Jesus said, yeah, every stone's going to be thrown down, he was talking about the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. That was going to happen. That was going to happen. But when he talks about the abomination that causes desolation being set up, and when he talks about all those things that's concerning that last 7 years that Daniel is speaking of, they say all that is in the future. And so it's not a past thing. It's all in the future. And what happens between then and that final 7 years is the church age. So once Jesus made that proclamation, once he went to his crucifixion, resurrection, and ascended to heaven, that there's a period of time called the church age. And then after the church age, that's when that 7 year period will come. So that would mean that most of the revelation is irrelevant to our age. And what they would say is even irrelevant to the church as a whole. Now, the latter chapters, chapter 20 to the end, would have relevance. You know, the first three chapters that are written to the churches in the area have relevance. But the bulk of the revelation is not relevant to us as a church, because if that futurist position is an idea of a premillennial rapture of the church, I mean, pre-tribulation rapture of the church, this being the great tribulation, that time that Jesus spoke of, that the church will be raptured and will be taken out before that last 7 years takes place. Okay? So that's one way of looking at this position. So looking at that as a futurist, the futurist just says, look, the church will be gone before any of this happens. Now, some people in a futurist position will actually say this. They will actually believe that the first half of that tribulation period, the first 3.5 years, the church will experience it, but then the church will leave and be raptured and taken away before the completion of that, okay? Before that last 3 years, 3.5 years. And so either way, the church is gone when you get to the actual last 3.5 years of Revelation. Now, hope that makes sense to you. So we now have two pretty simple ways of looking at it. One is, as we look at it like the preterists do, that it all happened in the past. There's a lot of evidence that a lot happened during that generation, and then the church age picks up after that. The other is that this is all future, and that the church age stands in the gap. And so that would be between verse 26 of Daniel chapter 9 and verse 27, there's this period of time. At the end of verse 26, it says that war will continue until the end. So they would say, okay, this is that period in which there's still war, there's still struggle, there's still stuff going on, but we aren't at the tribulation yet. Church will be gone before the tribulation happens. Make sense? Now, both that position and the preterist position are well known by a lot of people. Now, is there another way of looking at it? And the other way of looking at it, I want to share with you now, and that is what we would call the relevant position. So the relevant position is based on a few things. So let me talk about it before we start demonstrating it for you. That the relevant position is based on a foundational principle or a foundational characteristic of prophecy. And that foundational characteristic of prophecy is that prophecy has immediate relevance. Okay, so that's the reason we call it the relevant position. It has immediate relevance, and then it has a timeless relevance, and then it has an ultimate relevance and ultimate fulfillment. Okay, so an immediate relevance, a timeless relevance, and an ultimate fulfillment and relevance in the future. Now, let me demonstrate that with a couple of examples. Like if you take Daniel and the visions that he had concerning the lion, the bear, the leopard, and the beast with the terrible teeth, the ferocious and fearful and terrifying beast. If you take that vision and you say, well, that lion and that bear and that leopard were very relevant to what was going on then. And as Media Persia, as Daniel was prophesying forward, he was actually living in the period of time in which the lion was at work, and that was the kingdom of Babylon. So it had immediate relevance in that the lion was there. It also had some timeless relevance in that as time went on, you started seeing what happened as the Persians took over. So the Medo-Persian regime or kingdom, and then you go into the Grecian, the Greeks, and what happened with Alexander and all that happened there. And you just see amazing ways the relevance of that as it went on. It had tremendous relevance. But then you look into Revelation chapter 13, and you'll see that same imagery used again. Here comes that same imagery with the leopard and the bear and the lion, and you go like, wow, there was even a greater ultimate significance to that prophecy even than what we would have seen early on in it. All right, so that idea that prophecy has an immediate relevance, it has a timeless relevance, and then it has an ultimate relevance or fulfillment in the end. Look at it a couple of other places just so you can kind of lay the foundation of that. How many people, I hope that you were reading as we read together at Christ United, we read every day, we're reading through the Bible. You've recently read through Jeremiah and Ezekiel. And I don't know if you've noticed this, but when it comes to the prophecy of the fall of Jerusalem and what would happen with the exile to Babylon, over and over and over again, not just through one prophet, but through actually several prophets, you see the same thing being talked about with different images and different reflections in different ways. So reiteration of those things, you know what I'm saying? And we're gonna say it over, and we're gonna say it over, and we're gonna say it over, and we're gonna do it. That reiteration is also a character and quality of prophecy. So we have that beautiful truth that there's an immediate relevance, there's a timeless relevance, and there is an ultimate relevance, and prophecy is often reiterated as God is bringing forth that truth. So let's look at the great way that you see this at work in what Jesus was talking about. When that prophecy was made by Daniel, and Daniel was saying, hey guys, it's going to come down to 69 weeks, and then there's going to be that 70th week, and all that stuff was being done. Well, they knew it meant something, the weeks, but they didn't know what it meant for sure. And what happened later on, it was in 168 BC, that the temple was there, and you had the temple invaded, and it was just a horrific time. It was by Antiochus Epiphanes. And Antiochus Epiphanes took over Jerusalem, took over the temple, set up an altar to Zeus in the temple, sacrificed a pig on the altar. The abomination that causes desolation, the Jews were so sure of that because he was demanding that he be worshipped, that Zeus be worshipped, sacrificed the most unclean animal imaginable in the temple. He desecrated it 168 BC, and every Jew knew this is the fulfillment of Daniel chapter 9, verse 27. This is the abomination that causes desolation. It led to the uprising of Judas Maccabeus and the Maccabean revolt and the Hasmonean dynasty and all that happened after that. And it was such a part of the Jewish belief and their understanding that if you've ever heard of Hanukkah celebrates that revolt that came up against Antiochus Epiphanes. Now, so Hanukkah, the Jewish belief, the whole system that's in there, that whole depth of belief that they had about this, when Jesus says, look, when you see the abomination that causes desolation standing in the holy place that was spoken of through the prophet Daniel, guess what? They've already gone like, no, wait a minute. We already saw that in the past. There was already that relevance, right? That relevance and that prophecy seemed to be completely fulfilled in Antiochus Epiphanes. And then Jesus says, know when you see it. So he's saying there's still going to be a further fulfillment of that. And that further fulfillment, the destruction of the Jerusalem in 70 AD, guys, it's amazing how beautifully and powerfully it fulfills that prophecy. But as you look at that, if there is immediate relevance and there's timeless relevance and then an ultimate fulfillment in the way of prophecy, then that whole notion of immediate, timeless, and ultimate fulfillment, you start seeing prophecy in a beautiful way. Watch the prophecies about Jesus himself through Isaiah, through Jeremiah, through Hosea, through Micah. As you look at those prophecies, they would have immediate relevance to what was going on. They, of course, have timeless relevance. You can see application, but they found their ultimate fulfillment in Jesus. And so with that, watch what happens as you look at that in the Revelation, okay? If you look at that in the Revelation, and you look at the immediate relevance. The immediate relevance of the revelation and what was happening there, if you go back and just read and listen and look and pay attention, you will recognize that the fulfillment of what was happening, the relevance of the revelation to that time is undeniable. Especially, and I was talking to a friend and she asked me, when do you see the dating of the book of Revelation? And I just said, you know, I've never dismissed, you know, around 95 AD, but I'm definitely open to other evidence because it's never been that big of a deal to me as to when it was written. But she calls me to think. And so I started looking. I started seeing internal evidence for the book being written earlier, like in the 60s. And then internal evidence in the book itself, where, you know, the temple is still in existence and other things like that. So with all that being done, looking at that potential even earlier date for it, either way, doesn't matter. If you look at what was happening in the Roman Empire during that whole period of time, it has enormous relevance. So much so, guys, that when it came to identifying the beast and the mark of the beast, which we'll talk about next week, there are transcripts that have, instead of 666, they have 616 instead of 666 for the mark of the beast. And if you know, the name Nero Caesar can be spelled two different ways. And with one of those, the absence of 50 leaves 616. And so there was no doubt they had Nero Caesar in mind. So there was this amazing relevance to that period of time. But we all know it wasn't fully fulfilled in that time. Then there's a timeless relevance. I want you to think about the timeless relevance and think, well, what happened during things like, let's take the Nazi regime. During the Nazi regime, was there the kind of evil at work? Was John, when he said, and I think it's 1 John 2, I'm really embarrassed that I'm hesitating on that. But John said, many antichrists have already appeared. Right? And he said, look, Antichrist, the spirit of Antichrist is at work. The Antichrist is coming. Many have already appeared. Is it possible that the work of the Antichrist that was prophesied all the way back to Daniel was at work in Antiochus Epiphanes, was at work in Nero, but also was at work in people like Hitler? The interesting thing is, if you swore allegiance to Hitler, you'd be good. You could have your own money and the Jews' money, right? Now, that would happen. But if you denied that, and as a true follower of Christ stood up for Jesus, like Dietrich Bonhoeffer was, you were killed. So the relevance of that, timeless relevance, is amazing. Now, will there be a future and ultimate fulfillment of that? Will there be a climactic fulfillment of that? What we know from Scripture is I think the answer is absolutely yes. I know. We know that the answer will be absolutely yes. And so what's beautiful is that ultimate fulfillment still to come, Jesus was just saying in this first generation, everything was done that would need to be done for me to come back. And then generation by generation, and that's one of the things in the study of Revelation that I did early on in my life, it was so cool to look just decade after decade even, but especially century after century after century, you would see different things where people say, look, it looks like this could be lining up for the end. Now for us, the church age is like this. This is the church age. That from the moment that Jesus was speaking to his disciples on the Mount of Olives, he wanted them to understand the time is short. The time is short. The reality is that before this generation passes away, everything will have been completed, and the time is short. So the church lives in this always, that it was the intention of Jesus that his disciples who were on the Mount of Olives with him would think and know and believe in reality that Jesus could come back any minute. Once they saw the abomination that causes desolation in the temple, they could know, wait a minute. The reality is once we've seen these things take place, then we know the time could happen. And generation by generation, they desired, that is Jesus and all the apostles desired, that we recognize we are living in the last days. Now, I want you to know that I said this was proportional, right? I said the thing was proportional, and you might be going like, man, your proportions are really messed up there, because this is supposed to be 2,000 years. This is supposed to be, you know, like 83 years. This looks way too big for 3.5 years or 7 years. And I say 3.5 because most of us believe that it's actually 3.5 years that are left to be culminated. But here we go. Or many of us believe that. That is more like it. That's more like the period of time that we have left. When Jesus wanted his disciples to know that the time was short, he wanted them to know that that time is very short. That little period of time that left over is microscopic. We are right there on the edge, right there at the end. Now here's what I want to ask you to do. I don't want you to like, okay, let me share this position and share what Jeff said, or share what somebody else said, or share what this person said. I want you to simply read the Bible for yourself. I want you to read what Jesus said and just ask yourself the question, do I think that what Jesus was saying was, this I'm speaking to you now while you guys are sitting with me is really for a future generation? I'm not really speaking it for you, but I'm speaking for a future generation. Or do you feel like he's speaking directly to them? Do you believe that he wants them to know that before their generation passes away? So as you look at verses 32 and 33, and you hear him say, you know, look at the fig tree. When the branches become tender and the leaves come out, you know that spring is near. In the same way, when you see all these things, you know that it's near, right at the door. And then he says, I tell you that this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Now, for those of us who listen to that and hear what Jesus said, we just believe Jesus was real clear. He was saying, look, it's right there. And then he goes on to say the day and the hour, nobody's going to know. But he says it's going to come like that. It's going to come like the flood that came when all the people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. And the flood came and took them all away because they weren't paying attention. He's saying, you need to be ready. And he said, you need to keep watch because you don't know the day or the hour. He goes on to say, understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. All those things that Jesus said, if you read it for yourself and ask yourself the question, is he talking to them, intending that they would see they are at that last breath. That's where Jesus wants us all to realize is we're right at the end. And he wanted that to continue through all the generations for every other person he would knit together in their mother's womb to bring into existence for the purpose of an eternity. He wanted every one of us to recognize that we need to live our lives aware that eternity is what matters and not focus so much on this little blip of a life that we have. If that is the intention of Jesus, as you read it, you'll see that. And then I want you to go on, if you would, and also read what those people who sat on the Mount of Olives think. And just read what they said and see what you think they thought. As in Peter, whenever the church began with the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, Jesus quoted from Joel, who said, in the last days, this would be happening. In the last days, I'll pour out my Spirit on all people. If you look in the first letter that he wrote, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 20, he says, look, here's the thing, that Jesus appeared or came to us in the last time. It's like he's saying it's in this last time. And whenever people were starting to, if you could understand how Peter was teaching, he was saying Jesus could come back any minute. And so people were mocking him for that and mocking others. And he says in his second letter in chapter 3, verses 3 and 4, he says, look, you know, understand this. In the last day, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. Where is this coming, he promised, they'll say. Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the creation of the world. He goes on and says this, though, but do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. You understand what Jesus had told him was, I'm coming. And I'm coming soon. And Peter's saying, if you think that he's slow in keeping that promise, don't think he's slow at all. He's patient. He's wanting you to be able to come to repentance before he comes back. Because when he comes back, it's going to be too late from that point forward. Go on and read in Matthew chapter 25 and read the parable of the 10 virgins and see if you think Jesus was saying, this is only for some future generation, or was Jesus saying, you need to keep watch. You don't know what hour I'm coming. So if you would just read it for yourself, read what Peter said, read what Jesus said, read what John himself said. John said, He said, my dear brothers, it's chapter 2, verse 18 in his epistle. And I think it's the first epistle. Yes, it's definitely first epistle. So 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. I sure hope I got that one right. But he said this. He said, dear friends, or dear children, I'm sorry. He says, I love the way he calls them children. He says, dear children, this is the last hour. Now, y'all remember, the whole idea is not literally. He's not talking about literal hour. This is the last hour. And he said, and you've heard that the Antichrist is coming, and indeed many Antichrists have come. This is how we know it's the last hour. Read what John himself wrote. Then read the Revelation, and as you read what he wrote to the churches, to those early churches, ask yourself the question, just put you and God, read it, and ask, is this saying that this revelation is relevant to them? Is he telling them they're in it right now, and they need to be in that place right now of absolute readiness? I believe you'll find that answer to be true. Now, here's the beautiful truth, is whether you are a person who believes that in this relevant view of Scripture, or you believe in the view that there is a church age between now and a thing called the rapture, right? If that happens, oh yeah, here, the church age, and the church will be raptured and taken back. Either way, the truth is we all believe the same reality, and that is that it could happen any minute. It could happen any minute. And so what I want to ask you to do is to get back to what we had in the beginning. All of this represented such a very, very minute period of time. On that line that we had, you remember the rope that stretches to the far ends of the universe. And we said to you that the time that we have, all of human history is less than that line on that span of eternity. And your life is just a speck within that line. And he's saying, are you going to live your life as though that is what matters? Because you were created for eternity. And you will spend eternity, even in the paradise that I've prepared for you, or you'll spend eternity literally tormented forever in the absence of anything good and any love, anything good. And so when you get to the end of the Revelation, you hear him talking about this new heaven and this new earth. And there's such purity and such blessing and such preciousness about that vision. You got to read it and just say, what's he saying? He's saying, man, it's going to be full of nothing but love, nothing but good. He said, nothing that is impure will enter it. Nothing that is deceitful will enter it. The truth is that nobody who does deceitful and shameful things will have any place in this new creation. And he's saying, I want you to know that I'm preparing. That's what I have for you, and that's what I want for you. And I'm just wanting you to be a part of it. And you only have now to make your decision. You only have now. And so please hear this. Please hear this. And would you just settle it in your heart? If God wants us to live like that, if he wants us to live understanding that tomorrow could be our last day, some people look at it like, well, that means I need to dig a big bomb shelter, and I need to get a bunch of guns, and I need to stack up a bunch of food, and I need to be, because the end time is coming. That thinking is so contrary to the heart of Jesus and to the Christian life, I can't even conceive of it. The reality is if you truly believe that this could be my last day, you know what you're going to want to do? You're going to want to love. You're going to want to reach out to the people that you love and let them know that you love them. You're going to desperately want everybody that you love to be a part of that eternity that's being prepared for them. And you're going to be looking forward to a time when you look in a world filled with all kinds of chaos and riots and hatred and anger and injustice and impurity and all the junk around us. And you know that he's got something waiting for us. In the movie, Remember the Titans, it was so beautiful. It's a story about two football players who were brought together from different races, from different schools to become one team. And these two players on this team, Gary Bertier and Julius, were partners, but they had hated each other when they roomed together. And they violently struck out, but they ended up really loving each other. Bertier ended up being really hurt bad, paralyzed in a car accident. And comes from a true story anyway, but as Julius was sitting with him, he said, man, you can't be hurt like this. I should have been with you. And he said, no, if you've been with me, you've been hurt just like I was. And then Julius said this. Bertier said, look, man, I was afraid of you. And all that I could see was what I was afraid of. And now I realize I was only hating my brother. And then Julius responded by saying, Well, listen, when all this is over, you and me, we're going to move out into the same neighborhood. He said, we're going to get old. We're going to get fat. He said, and there ain't going to be any more of this black and white between us. That vision that he saw of like something in the future where we could get rid of the hatred and get rid of the anger and get rid of the brokenness and get rid of the mess. That's the vision. That's the thing that Jesus created us for. And that's what he's saying, that that end of this age and that beginning of that age is right at the door. Don't you want to be a part of it? You won't get fat. You won't get old. But you can live in relationships where there's no more sorrow, no more pain, no more crying, no more tears, no more death, no more hatred, no more lying, no more jealousy, no more envy, no more racism, no more fighting. Just live in the love that God created us for forever. You don't have more time. You don't have more time. Jesus has made as plain as he can possibly make it. You are now in the end time. We have ever since he spoke to his disciples on that mountain, and he speaks to you again today from that mountain. He just says, look, you need to decide now. Lord God, would you allow us, those of us who have come together to worship, or those who are listening, but right now, Jesus, we were hoping that you would make it plain, and we hope that it's plain in the hearts of everybody here, that the bottom line of everything is that the eternity for which we are created is right at the door. We are in the last days. We always have been. You've never wanted us to see it any other way. Lord, help us to love like that. Help us to live like that. And if we don't yet know you as our Lord, as our God, as our Savior, if we don't yet know that we are forgiven and loved and we haven't invited you into our hearts and our lives to make us fit for that eternity, then right now, Lord God, we want to do that. And so anybody that's listening, if you've never done that, here's what Jesus made clear. He came to make that atonement for every sin. He came that he would, when he was going to that cross 3 days later, he was going to pay the price so you could be forgiven of all your sin. And he said he would come into your heart by his Holy Spirit. He would come back and come and pour out his love into your heart. He would begin making you the person you need to be so that paradise that he's created, you can live in it. You can be a part of it. So can you say to him right now, I want to be forgiven now. I want you in my heart now. Eternity could begin for me in the blink of an eye, and I want that eternity to be spent with you. And I want it to be spent in love, not in torturous hatred. And so I come to you, please forgive me, and I ask you to come into my heart and my life. I want to belong to you. So when you come back, you're coming for me. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, and as we worship, we just invite you to consider what really matters and where we really ought to be putting the focus of our lives. God bless you.